There's an idea that many scientists believe that if it became widely accepted, it would literally end society as we know it. And it stems from the question, why do we do the things that we do? You see, humans have a sense that we control ourselves and our environment a lot more than we actually do. But what if I told you that free will doesn't exist? And there was a famous experiment in the 1980s that proved it, where participants were hooked up to a brain monitoring machine that showed their brains were making the decisions for them 300 milliseconds before they became aware of their own choice. Your brain makes that decision for you. It's after that decision has been made in your subconscious that your brain becomes aware, and you become convinced you're in the process of making that decision. And the second argument actually has to do with this video. How did you choose to watch it? Well, most of you probably scrolled by it and then made the decision to stay, but the decision you made to stay was only possible because I made this video. I was only able to make this video because I had access to the internet and a computer. Both the internet and computers were invented before I was born, so I never had the choice as to whether I wanted to be exposed to them in the first place. Yet, here we both are. The idea is that a decision is only truly ours if we control the circumstances, which we never do, but even then, our brain makes a decision about what we're going to do before we even know what we're going to do, which means that free will is an illusion. But our society is built on a reward and punishment system, and if no one is truly responsible for their circumstances, then what does it all mean? That is all for this video, but as always, if this interested you and you want to see more like it, I'd really appreciate it if you followed along. Thank you. What makes something real? Are you and I real? Are the ideas we believe in or the money in our bank accounts real? The answer is a complicated no. You see, the world can only be put in two categories, myself and not myself. I have my own thoughts, feelings, and emotions, but there's no way I can be certain that you or anyone else does. It's impossible for me to see something from your perspective, or know what you're thinking, or know if you're even thinking at all. So as a result, we had to create instruments and tools to make sense of the world around us, even if we don't really understand it. Now, I want to give you an example of this. Imagine I hand you a piece of paper with the most offensive message I could possibly give you. More than likely, your body will have a physical reaction to that message, something like your face will flush or your heart will start to beat faster. Now, I could send you the exact same message in another language, and even though the message is the exact same and the physical conditions are the exact same, you'll have no reaction to it because you don't understand it. This is where objective reality comes into play, where something is only real if it would continue to exist even if there are no creatures around to perceive it. So things like colors, odors, and tastes and so on are not real because they wouldn't exist if nothing was around to experience them. Which makes sense, right? It's the same old saying you probably heard a million times. If a tree falls in the woods and no one is around to hear it, does it really make a sound? Well, the answer is no. But what if I told you that was the same for space-time? Things like objects, electrons, the sun, planets, etc. Which leads you down a bit of a rabbit hole. As you peel back more layers of reality and what makes it real, you realize that the more we understand, the more we don't really know. And maybe we are just here because the universe wants to experience itself, or else it wouldn't exist. This is gonna be a 2 or 3 part series, so if that interests you, I'd really appreciate if you followed along. Thank you. Could there have been an advanced intelligent species that lived on Earth that we don't know about? The answer might surprise you. The Siluarian Hypothesis is a thought experiment which assesses modern science's ability to detect evidence of a prior advanced civilization millions and millions of years ago. And you might be thinking, no way, we have evidence of the dinosaurs who went extinct 65 million years ago. It's not possible that we missed something. Well, dinosaurs lived on Earth for 165 million years. There were over 20,000 trillion Tyrannosaurus rexes who lived, and we've only discovered 32 fossils. Now, in comparison, modern humans have only existed for 200,000 years. If we were to get completely wiped out tomorrow, the trace that we would leave behind would be so hard to detect in 65 million years from now. So who is to say something as intelligent as us wasn't here before the dinosaurs? Well, what you would have to look for, and what will be the evidence that we leave behind, is the large but temporary spike in CO2 levels that we leave in our sediment, which by that time will be hundreds of meters underground. But even then, it would be nearly impossible to tell whether that spike was caused by something natural or not. But nevertheless, this is exactly what we're looking for on planets like Mars, to see if they once homed an intelligent species. We all know that our odds of existence, actually being alive on this planet, in this galaxy, in this universe, were extremely unlikely, and almost an infinite amount of odds were defied in order for you to be alive sitting here watching this video. The odds were so incredibly slim that, according to physicist Ludwig Boltzmann, it's actually a lot more likely that instead of an entire universe being born out of matter, with humans and animals and planets and so on, that nature produced one single self-aware entity floating in this void that believes it is a person in a world full of people, history, and laws of nature. This idea is known as the Boltzmann Brain Paradox, and relies on the question, what's easier to create out of nothing? One brain, or an entire universe? Which would mean nothing is really there, except for your self-awareness making all of this up to help pass the time. And while physicist Brian Greene said he's confident that he is not a Boltzmann brain, he would like our theories to also concur with this, which so far they have been unable to do. If I asked you what color was on the screen right now, unless you're colorblind, you would tell me that it's red. But how do I know that my red isn't your blue? You see, we're only able to identify colors because at some point in your life, someone pointed to something and told you what color it was. The ocean is blue, grass is green, bananas are yellow, you get the idea. But we actually might perceive these colors completely differently, and if you don't believe me, let me remind you of the blue and black dress. So we actually don't know how far this goes, but we do know that color perception does vary person by person. So it very well could be that my red is actually your purple. On top of that, humans don't even see a fraction of all of the colors on this planet, with the mantis shrimp seeing 10 times more color than us. Now, try to imagine a new color because you can't. What if instead of life being a byproduct of the universe was a byproduct of life? Now, hear me out. The idea of biocentrism was introduced by biologist and theoretical physicist Robert Lanza in the early 2000s. According to his theory, the universe doesn't exist independently of life. Instead, it was created and sustained by life. So, instead of just space and time that make up the structure of the universe, it would be space, time, and consciousness. And now, nearly 14 billion years later, consciousness channels itself through living organisms to experience space and time. Lanza has used two arguments to back his theory up. The first is the double slit experiment, which I don't have time to get into, but proves that at the quantum level, the fundamental aspects of reality change, whether humans are observing it or not. And the fine-tuning problem, which shows that there are so many conditions to the universe that made it just right for life, that it seems incredibly unlikely that any of this should be possible. But if consciousness played a part in the formation of our universe, just like space and time, it would aim for a reality that works. Now, like any theory related to the nature of life, there are plenty of people who disagree, but it's interesting to think about. Do you remember in Interstellar when Cooper and his team went down to Miller's planet, where the famous
"Those aren't mountains, they're waves"
scene took place? Well, on Miller's planet, the characters experience something called time dilation, where every hour on the planet is 7 years back in space. And it's a very real thing. If you're an astronaut on the International Space Station, and you stay up there for 6 months, you've aged 0.005 seconds less than everyone here on Earth, which isn't a huge change at all, but the faster you travel, the more extreme time dilation gets. If you're traveling at 90% the speed of light, and you're going somewhere 10 light years away, from a stationary observer on Earth, that trip is going to take you 22 years. But for you, traveling that fast, both space and time begin to dilate, so that trip is only going to take you about 9 years. So if you left at 20 years old and had a twin, when you get back to Earth, you'll be 29 years old, and your twin will be 42, meaning essentially you've time traveled into the future. There's been a lot of talk online recently about people having an inner monologue or not. Apparently it's only around like 26%, and people study this. It's called the science of the inner experience, and there are five different ways that people can think. The first is inner speaking, which is like a constant stream of dialogue in your head. So they're thinking verbally, like, I need to go to the store and get this item. Then you have inner seeing, which is thinking more visually. So instead of thinking, oh, I need to go to the store, they would be seeing the items they need from the store in their head. Inner feeling, which is a conscious experience of emotional processes that manifest in a physical way. So they're feeling their thoughts instead of actually thinking them. Unsymbolized thinkers that have no word or image associated with any of their thoughts. And sensory awareness, where their minds are paying attention to sensory stimulation from their environment. Now, you could be 100% of one of these, or a mix of them, but I am interested to hear from you guys about which category you'd put yourself in. You might already be a billionaire and you don't even know it. If you were to ask Jeff Bezos, who has a net worth of $165 billion, if he would trade some of that for more time, I can almost guarantee you that he would. I mean, he's funding an entire company with the goal of human immortality, so I think that one is pretty clear. Now, there's a huge difference between 1 million and 1 billion. 1 million seconds is 11 days, and a billion seconds is 31 years. If you have a billion seconds left on the clock, you are in abundance of the most precious resource in our universe, which is time. You have enough time to take the wrong job, marry the wrong person, make the wrong choice, try 100 different things and fail at 99 of them, because you have enough time to recover from any mistake. Over 40% of billionaires globally are over the age of 70. How many of them do you think would give up their entire fortune for another billion seconds? Now, what about 2 billion seconds? At one point in your life, probably when you were still pretty young, you realized that your time on this earth was limited. Yours, your families, your friends, and so on. And when you thought about it a little more, you realized that was the same for everything. And every day since that day, you've lived with the knowledge that you are one day closer to the end of your life. Now, how do you live with that? The clock that's constantly counting down. Well, there's something called terror management theory, which is essentially a defense system in our brains to protect us from this fact. And right now, watching this video, the thought of death has probably re-entered your brain, and your terror management system is currently kicking in. Your brain currently recognizes the thought, and it's going to use a number of suppression and rationalization techniques and defenses to prevent you from spiraling, including boosting your self-confidence, introducing thoughts of the world at large, reinforcing your identity, and distracting you. And shortly after you swipe away from this video, you won't be thinking about it anymore. If I push you down a flight of stairs, whether or not you believe in gravity, you're still gonna fall down those stairs. If you, me, and every other person on this planet stop believing in capitalism, the US dollar, freedom, and democracy, they would no longer exist because we made them all up. So how much of you and what you believe about your life and the world around you is actually real? You see, when you were born, you were given given a name. And as you grew up, your environment and life experiences shaped your ideas and perception of the world, but that's all it is, your perception. Perception itself is inherently a reduction of the information of the thing. Your perspective of it is a lot less total information than the actual thing is. For example, you can look at the Empire State Building from the east side, or the west side, or from above, but no matter which side you look at it from, you're missing the other five sides. There is no all-encompassing perspective that gives you all of the information about any situation, which means that reality can't be captured from any one perspective. So multiple perspectives have to be taken, which, by the way, is like the best argument ever for why diversity in any situation is important, but I'll leave that for another video. Either way, the reason humans have been so successful and dominant as a species is because not only can we cooperate in large numbers, but we can exchange new ideas and adjust ourselves accordingly. So remember that. Our success is thanks to the ability to not only share, but listen as well, and change our opinions when new information has been presented. I think I might have one more part in me, so if that interests you, I'd really appreciate if you followed along. Thank you. If you were given the opportunity to rebuild society however you saw fit, what would it look like? I mean, humans are inherently selfish, so it's safe to assume that given the opportunity, most people would design a society that reflects who they are and the situation they find themselves in. For example, if an ultra-wealthy person was asked this question, they would most likely design a society where they can earn as much as possible and enjoy the fruits of their labor. If a poor person was asked this question, they would most likely design a system that redistributes wealth. We're biased beings, that's just the way that it is. Now, what if I asked you that question again, but this time you had to create that society before you stepped into it, without knowing who you were going to be once you were inside of it. So you get to create this world, but then when you enter it, you're randomly assigned a gender, race, sexuality, and economic class. You could be fit, you might be in a wheelchair, you might be old, or you could be young. Would that society look any different from the first? John Rawls argued that it would, for every single person on the planet, and he called it the veil of ignorance, that people couldn't build a society in their image if they didn't know what that image was, so they would build it as fair as possible, to better their own odds once the veil had been lifted. I will say that not everyone agrees with him though, but it does beg the question, whose self-interest is our future society being built in? That is all for this video, but as always, if this video interested you and you want to see more like it, I'd really appreciate it if you click the plus. Thank you. Imagine that you wake up tomorrow and you're told about a new machine that had just been built, the experience machine. This machine is capable of generating a virtual reality for you that is indistinguishable from real life. The machine is fail-safe and will never suffer an error or a mechanical failure. It only has one setting, paradise, and you would experience endless pleasure once you are inside for the rest of your life. No real experience could possibly compete with the machine in terms of pleasure gained. All you would need to do is sign a form or two and get plugged in. If you choose to enter, you're never going to come out again, but you will live the rest of your life experiencing complete happiness. There are no adverse side effects, and specific pleasurable experiences can even be programmed into the simulation. You could have the job of your dreams, the house of your dreams, partner of your dreams, any and everything that could bring you happiness will be given to you. So, do you have a reason not to go in? It's an argument that stems from hedonism, the belief that pleasure is the only good and we should maximize it. And if we could, we would. But do you value real experiences and being a person who actually does things rather than just dreaming about them? And is there a difference if you can't tell that there is? Just something to think about. That is all for this video, but as always, if this interested you and you want to see more like it, I'd really appreciate it if you followed along. Thank you. The world just hit 8 billion people, each person with an unbroken lineage of life that goes back for 4 billion years. And it gets kind of weird when you think about it. The only way that you are even possible is because of the combination of your two parents. The odds of your parents meeting are about 1 in 20,000, but then it's another 1 in 2,000 that they actually stay together long enough to have kids. When it comes to the science of reproduction, the odds that that child is actually you is about 1 in 400 quadrillion. But then you have to keep going, because for your parents to meet, they had to be born too, so they defied the same odds, and so did their parents and their grandparents and so on. Your family tree, or your life lineage, whatever you want to call it, has remained unbroken for the past 4 billion years, all the way back to the first microorganisms. For 4 billion years, every single one of your ancestors has defied every single odd and kept the tree going. But for that to even happen, the universe had to be created in such a specific way that allowed for stars and planets to form, for Earth to be placed where it was, for asteroids to bring it water, and whatever gave those first microorganisms their first kick of life. So the odds of you, or me, or any of the other 8 billion people here on Earth is basically zero, but still today, 380,000 babies will be born, 230,000 people will get married, 10,000 people will retire, 700 million kids will go to school, and tomorrow, 300,000 people will experience the best day of their life, and it just might be you. That is all for this video, but as always, if this video interested you and you want to see more like it, I'd really appreciate it if you followed along. Thank you. A self-driving car is about to hit a pedestrian. No matter the outcome, someone isn't going to survive it. But let's say for this scenario, there's one person in the car and it's one pedestrian. Whose safety should the car prioritize? Its driver or the pedestrian? This is actually a question that was asked a few years back in the largest survey ever of machine ethics, which stemmed from a 2016 study that showed the ethical paradox of self-driving cars, where the vast majority of people said they wanted a self-driving car to protect pedestrians, even if it meant sacrificing its passengers, but they also said they wouldn't buy the vehicle if it was programmed to act this way. So the team surveyed 2.3 million people across 233 countries and territories and recorded 40 million different decisions. There were 13 different scenarios, ranging from whether the pedestrian was crossing illegally, how old the pedestrian was, what their socioeconomic class was, and their gender. And what it really revealed is that no one could really agree, and answers varied significantly depending on where in the world the participants were. But it is something that needs to be considered, especially considering the fact that 1 in 10 vehicles on the road by the end of the decade will be fully autonomous. That is all for this video, but as always, I'd really appreciate it if you followed along. Thank you. Young people think about their future an average of 59 times per day. 29% of them think the apocalypse will happen in their lifetime. 25% of them think it's immoral to have children given the state of the world. And the vast majority have a pessimistic view about the collective future, which is kind of funny because the majority still has an optimistic view about their personal future, just not the world at large. But the way that we envision the future is ever changing, and the construction of these scenarios has a major impact on what we do and how we think in the present. You see, there's this thing called the growing block theory of time that states the only things that are real are the past and the present. The future doesn't exist yet. We in the present get to create that future and then add that next block. There was a study in 2018 that asked participants whether they thought we were headed towards a utopian or dystopian society, separated the two, and then asked them a number of questions. The utopian thinkers were far less likely to accept the status quo, less likely to justify current systems, and were far more likely to engage in pro-social behavior like voting, donating, and activism. If the collective mindset was that we were capable and we were going to create a positive future, it would inspire us to focus on the problems at hand and go make it a reality, because it is possible if we believe that it is. That is all for this video, but as always, if this interested you and you want to see more like it, I'd really appreciate it if you followed along. Thank you. Have you ever been listening to a playlist on shuffle and thought to yourself, oh, I really hope that this song comes on next, and then the next song comes on and it was exactly the one that you were hoping for? Well, maybe it wasn't a coincidence after all, because in 1995, a team of French scientists created a robot with one specific task: to move around a room completely randomly. Then they took a bunch of baby chicks and placed them inside of the room with the robot. And the thing is with baby chickens is that they will imprint on the first moving thing that they encounter and adopt it as their mother. Once these chicks had imprinted on the robot, they were removed from the room and the robot moved around randomly as normal. But when they were placed back in the room, the robot's movements were no longer random, and it spent over 200% more time around the chicks than anywhere else, which led the scientists to conclude in that study that the chicks' imprint had a psychokinetic influence on the robot's movements. Since then, there have been hundreds of studies from the CIA to Princeton to try and see if human thought can affect the outcome of a random number generator, and time again, they've concluded that it does.
Picture this: you get to the end of your life, you kick the bucket, and then it's all over. But then something happens, you wake up again, and you're not in heaven or hell or any other form of afterlife. You're actually in your bedroom in the year 2342. And you're not the age you were when you passed. You're actually 16 and you just finished an immersive game in a virtual world that simulates the primitive and exciting world of the 21st century. And before you scroll away thinking this is too far-fetched, what if I told you that it's not? And there are a number of scientists who have spoken openly about how this is a very real possibility, including Elon Musk, Yuval Harari, and Neil deGrasse Tyson. You see, you need to start thinking about the level of progress we've achieved over the past 100 years and what we could achieve in the next 100. The first video game in 1958 looked like this, and video games now look like this and can be played completely in VR. Everything you experience is a result of electrical activity in your brain, and theoretically, it would be completely possible to manipulate that activity to experience something else entirely, and you wouldn't be able to distinguish it from your true reality. And if that's possible in the future, then who is to say it hasn't happened already? Think of it this way: there is one real physical world, but there are infinite possible virtual worlds. Mathematically speaking, the odds you find yourself in the one true real world are almost zero. And I know we like to joke about NPCs, but philosophers determined thousands of years ago there is no way to conclusively prove that anyone other than yourself is actually conscious. So it very well could be an entirely simulated world where you are the only one actually experiencing anything. Maybe not, but maybe. That's all for this one, but as always, if this interested you and you want to see more like it, I would really appreciate it if you followed along. Thank you.